the witness stand in a shooting case. I'm Jack LeGoff. John Kelly and I will have these stories and more coming up on Channel 7 Action News.
Al Ackerman with sports, Marilyn Turner with the weather, Ben Marshall with a report on the Swainson trial, Dave Whitman with a dollars and cents tip on buying firewood, and Troy Dungan with a report on restoring old autos. All join Jack LeGoff, John Kelly, and Detroit's number one news team for Channel 7's 6 o'clock Action News next.
At Shifrin Williams Jewelers, this elegant diamond dinner ring is only $99. You save $26. That'll make you happy. Yes, we
can. Think what you are risking for the sake of one Jewish baby.
Schneller! Schneller!
PG.
Limited engagement at a neighborhood theater. Consult your local newspaper for starting times.
These are four elegant luxury cars. But you know something interesting? The only one with front-wheel drive for better tracking. The one with the most trunk space. And the one with the best gas mileage by far is also the one that costs $5,000 less than the others. So you can have a luxury car and something left over for a rainy day. The answer is Audi.
See the Porsche and Audi at Tom Sullivan Porsche Audi and Howard Cooper Porsche Audi. Spencer's Mountain tomorrow morning on AM Prize Movie with Rita Bell. This is Channel 7's 6 o'clock Action News with Jack LeGoff, John Kelly, and Detroit's number one news team.
Good evening. I'm John Kelly. Here's what's happening. Vice President Nelson Rockefeller did a rewrite on Calvin Coolidge today, saying he does not choose to run with President Ford in next year's election. Rockefeller wrote the president a long letter taking himself out of the race and delivered it personally to the White House this morning. Rockefeller did not say why he's dropping out or what he plans to do in the future. Michigan Republican Chairman William McLaughlin says the Rockefeller's pullout could very well hurt President Ford's chances in the election. The president himself announced today he will replace Defense Secretary John Schlesinger and CIA Director William Colby. The shakeup is apparently the result of Mr. Ford's desire to set up his own team. Sources say that Schlesinger got the word Sunday morning. The action apparently the result over some friction with Secretary of State Kissinger concerning detente with Russia.
Did you quit? Well, I have no comment to make.
What do you think this will do about the battle for the defense budget on Capitol Hill? Will it hurt?
I would hope that it would help.
How so?
Your replacement would hope that it would help.
CIA Director William Colby says he's not surprised by the move. Colby says it's the president's prerogative to put whomever he chooses in such posts.
Looking back at it now, you wish maybe you'd taken a firmer stand with some of the committees in Congress and perhaps not given them quite as much information as you have.
No,
would you do it differently?
I don't think so. I think the best way was to get rid of the past and transition into a future, the intelligence under the Constitution and in the new structure.
What is your projection for the CIA? Would you have any advice for a successor based on your own experience?
Oh, I think as you know, I've often said that an outsider would be appropriate for the job, and I think that makes sense still.
Mr. Colby says he plans to return to the practice of law privately. President Ford plans a news conference on those dismissals on 7:30. Channel 7 and ABC will carry the news conference live. Jack? John, Michigan State Bar Association President George Bushnell has called for John B. Swainson to resign as a justice of the Michigan Supreme Court in the wake of his conviction yesterday on 3 counts of perjury. At the same time, Bushnell was extremely critical of the conduct of Robert Ozer, the chief prosecutor of the Organized Crime Task Force, during the trial. Channel 7 newsman Van Marshall, who covered the trial, has this post-verdict report.
Jack, Swainson's attorney Conrad Cole does not believe Swainson should step down from the high court at this time, despite the fact he stands convicted of perjury. Cole said had the government not waited nearly 3 years to seek an indictment, there would not have been a perjury conviction. He said further that had the government questioned the late Chief Justice Thomas M. Kavanaugh, he would have completely exonerated Justice Swainson. But the government did not seek an indictment until after Justice Kavanaugh was dead. Cole also revealed that Swainson had testified before the grand jury against his advice because the justice believed, as a member of the judiciary, he had an obligation to do so. Had he refused to testify, as he had every right to do, he would now be free of all charges.
After all, he has been acquitted of the basic charges against him, and I would hope at least that the judge would look more favorably now upon these motions that we have filed.
Let me ask you just this. Is it your view that John Swainson is a victim of a railroad job by Robert Ozer and the strike force?
I think that I express my own views now, you understand that, but I think that this grand jury procedure is basically unfair. Because, as I indicated before, there's no opportunity to cross-examine any witnesses. You don't even know what witnesses have appeared before the grand jury. You don't know what evidence they've assembled. And let's give you an indication. When John Swainson went before the grand jury, he did not have any telephone locks. Recall the evidence established that back in 1973, the grand jury had subpoenaed John Swainson's telephone logs, office and home, unbeknownst to John Swainson. Now, if he'd had those telephone logs, he could readily have made reference to them and seen that there was a telephone call that he made on October the 6th. And I think clearly we wouldn't have that perjury charge and conviction at this time.
Do you think it was railroaded?
You want me to use that word railroaded, and I don't think I'm going to use that term. I'm saying
his Ozer trying to make a name for himself.
Well, I think perhaps only Mr. Ozer could answer that question, and I don't propose to speak for him.
I tried to talk with Mr. Ozer, but he wouldn't talk with me. Three times we tried without success to reach him by phone to seek an appointment. Then I went to his office in person. I was handed a written statement defending what Bar Association President George Bushnell had called Ozer's irresponsible conduct at the trial. I asked if Mr. Ozer would see me in person. The answer was no. I asked if there was a reason. The answer was no. Bushnell, incidentally, although he has called for Swainson to step down, told me he hopes and prays the verdict is overturned.
When a man seeks public office, when a man holds even a quasi-public office, such as I do right now, we give up certain rights that are given to other citizens.
Do you think John Swainson was railroaded by Robert Ozer and the strike force?
I can't answer that question as you put it, Mr. Marshall. All I know about this trial is what I've read in the papers. I have serious and grave concerns about the conduct of representatives of the Department of Justice throughout this entire matter.
You think John Swainson got a bad bum rap? That's a dirty, rotten thing?
If I was speaking personally, I might well adopt that language. I am not speaking personally, and as a consequence, I cannot comment on that. I'll say this. John Swainson got a full and a fair trial. I may be personally disappointed in the result, and I am. I may be personally upset by the result, and I am. But I don't question in one particular but what he had every right guaranteed to everyone as a citizen.
You obviously don't think he's guilty.
I've known this man for 25 years, and there has been, and I've known him well and intimately, and there has been nothing in our association that would give rise to the slightest suspicion that he would be guilty of the crime as charged.
Well, although there has been a trial and a verdict, the final chapter has not yet been written in the case of the United States versus John B. Swainson. Jack?
Then there have been a lot of questions raised and a lot of eyebrows raised concerning Whalen, a convicted felon, going free while a former Supreme Court justice and a former governor of the state of Michigan and a former World War II hero is convicted.
Well, there's no question that the government made a deal with Whalen. They admitted that. The court accepted it. He's had his first unlawful activity, as I understand it, was at the age of 11. I don't believe he's ever had a job. I know during the course of the investigation he was not gainfully employed, nor did he file an income tax return during those years. He, on the stand, you recall some time ago, he had said he bribed the state police. He readily admitted on the stand, I lied.
And he walks the streets. Thank you, Ben. John?
John Swainson has been a popular and influential man in the state of Michigan for many years. In an attempt to sample your feelings on his convictions, Channel 7 News found that while many people are disappointed in the man, some have renewed confidence in the system.
It's too bad that since the jury found him innocent of bribery, that he had to go commit perjury. But I think that is going to get him in trouble.
I think he's innocent, and that is really my opinion about it. He might be guilty, but I believe he's innocent.
It's pretty much about time we start putting an end to it. I think the Swainson trial is a good indication of how our system does work and how I think it should keep on working.
If Swainson indeed does appeal his convictions, he faces still, and if those appeals fail, he faces up to 15 years in prison and a maximum $6,000 fine.
Mayor Coleman Young says the man accused of the murder which triggered two nights of violence on the city's northwest side last July should be tried in Detroit. The mayor was a witness in one of two cases stemming from the Livernois-Finkel disturbance currently being tried in Recorder's Court.
The two cases are related only that they could be described as cause and effect of last summer's disturbance. Legally, the two murders are not connected. In Judge Joseph Gillis's court, James Henderson, Ronald Jordan, and Raymond Peoples are charged with the murder of Marion Pisco. One witness, Daniel Toomer, described vividly how Pisco was dragged from his car on Livernois and beaten to death. But neither he nor witnesses who followed were able to identify the three defendants as actual participants in that rock-throwing mob. In Judge Clarence Lester's courtroom, attorneys for Andrew Chenarian are asking for a change of venue. Chenarian is accused of murdering Obi Wynn outside his Livernois bar, an incident that triggered the 2 days of disturbances. The star witness, Mayor Coleman Young, would describe the situation as a racial conflict and potentially explosive. He also claimed a change of venue would increase the feeling of unrest in the community.
I think the implications behind a change of venue, namely that it is impossible for any person, black or white, to get a fair trial in our city, which is evenly divided between black and white, and whose citizens have shown a remarkable stability, maturity, and growing unity. I resent any implication that the citizens of Detroit cannot be fair.
The hearing before Judge Laster on the change of venue will continue tomorrow as attorney Neil Fink tries to prove his point that Andrew Chenarian cannot get a fair trial in Detroit. Jim Harrington, Channel 7 Action News reporting.
Police have no suspects in the weekend kidnapping of a prominent Lapeer County businessman. Edward Vesely owns the Vesely Manufacturing Company. They make the Apache recreational vehicles. Vesely was abducted at gunpoint from his home late Saturday. Channel 7's Ann Eskridge has details.
The hooded gunman pushed his way into the Vesely home. He tied up Ann Vesely, and then the gunman taped Eugene Vesely's eyes, stuffed a handkerchief in his mouth, tied his hands, and walked him to a car parked in a nearby field. Vesely was then driven some miles to a desolate and secluded barn. He was tied to a water pipe. In the meantime, Mrs. Vesely managed to free herself and call police. 2 hours after the abduction, police still had no leads until they got a call from a farmer. He told them that Vesely had escaped his captor and was at his farm, unhurt. The Lapeer County Prosecutor's Office believes that the kidnapper is from this area, only because he was familiar with the back roads and he knew the prominence of Eugene Vesely.
There was talk of money that the
at one point in the home, and a little later on as he was taken from the home, he was told to cooperate, that if he did, nothing would happen. There was some talk on the part of the captor indicating to Mr. Vesely that he should be worth, I don't know, it was a lot of money that he talked about. And so we gather that certainly that was the motive in abducting him.
The prosecutor told me that in his 5 years here, he's only known of one other kidnapping, and that case is still open. Ann Eskridge, Channel 7 Action News, reporting from Lapeer County.
The Detroit School Board is going to have to foot the bill for some new school buses. We'll have that story and more when Channel 7 Action News continues.
Hasn't been the same. Not since I discovered light and airy donuts from the Morton Donut Shop. And now Morton has something new. Three great tasting old-fashioned cake donuts. Plain, powdered, and sugar and spice. They're so rich and moist because they're made from a special recipe, the Donut Shop way. And frozen fresh, so they're fresh whenever you want them fresh. Tomorrow, let Morton turn your house into a donut shop.
Here's the fastest type relief known for occasional bronchial asthma attacks. Restores free breathing as fast as 15 seconds. It's in Primatene Mist. Or to keep breathing freely for hours, Primatene Tablets. In the lungs, Primatene opens clogged breathing tubes, relaxes bronchial spasms, restores free breathing. Primatene Mist, the fastest relief known. Primatene Tablets contains the asthma relievers doctors prescribe most.
Still to come on 7's Action News, a sports world report on freestyle skiing.
Comfort, yes, and confidence. This too is yours in Cordoba. Here is the confidence of knowing your automobile possesses a look of great dignity. With seats available in soft Corinthian leather. Plus the confidence one can only have in a truly roadworthy automobile. All this in a most surprisingly affordable small Chrysler. Cordoba.
You get a pretty good picture on your color set, right? But does this ever happen, or does this happen? Or maybe this, or this, or this? Well, what can you do about problems like these? You can get yourself a Sylvania GT-Matic 2. It has special circuits that help keep the picture looking good automatically without any help from you.
Sylvania GT-Matic, first true self-adjusting color set.
The Supreme Court handed the Detroit School District a bit of a setback today. The court refused to listen to arguments by the school district that it should not be required to pay for buses to aid in the desegregation of schools. District officials argue that the state is already on a survival budget with a projected $21 million deficit. If the district has to pay for the buses, it'll cost $2.6 million, and that's 25% of the cost of 150 vehicles.
A new bill is before Congress that would force HUD, the Department of Housing and Urban Development, to keep up its thousands of empty homes standing in the city of Detroit. Democratic Congressman William Broadhead of the city's 17th district introduced that bill today. He called HUD the most uncooperative of all federal agencies. Channel 7's Kelly Burke has more.
I asked Representative Broadhead where he and his colleagues have been. HUD's abandoned home problem has been news in Detroit for a long time. That's when he said that all past efforts within the usual channels of Washington's bureaucracy have failed. Broadhead's bill would require HUD to maintain vacant foreclosed homes just as any federal agency is required to maintain any of its buildings under General Services Administration guidelines. Broadhead, standing in front of a rotting hulk repossessed by HUD 2 years ago, applauded Mayor Young's decision recently to begin demolishing HUD properties without federal approval, even though that action may still bring criminal charges.
Well, I can't imagine any jury in Detroit convicting anybody of that kind of a criminal act. And if it would just be the height of ridiculousness if they would go ahead and try to make a criminal act out of something like this. This is what is a criminal act, what they've done to this neighborhood here and this house sitting here. And if you look two doors down, there's another one, and there's another one right up the street. Those are the criminal acts and not the act that the mayor took in trying to remove these eyesores from our neighborhoods.
Broadhead has sent letters to each member of each of the 13 congressional committees concerned with housing, urging an investigation into the HUD situation in Detroit, since Detroit has three times as many HUD-owned properties as any other city in the country. Kelly Burke, Channel 7 Action News, reporting.
Is it true, Al, that you spent considerable time at a ski show over the weekend covering one of your favorite subjects?
We have increased our sports staff almost 100%. We now have three people in our vast staff. We have Peter Heller along with Larry Adderley, which means when we have to go to the slopes, it's Heller or Adderley. What we're talking today about is hot dog skiing. It's probably the newest of all sports. Just a few years old, hot dogging is better known now as freestyle skiing. And our Peter Heller hit the slopes a few days ago, the artificial indoor slopes, that is, with one of the best freestylers in the world.
Well, it's November and the ski season is just about upon us, and the ski show was in town over the weekend, so I decided to come on down and spend some time with Bill O'Leary, who's a superstar in the hot dog skiing field, or as he would call it, the freestyle skiing field. He works out of Heavenly Valley in California, and we went up on the slopes. Bill tried to teach me some basics, but I was kind of a hopeless case. Bill, what you do is primarily freestyling or hot dog skiing as opposed to downhill or slalom, correct?
Right. I don't consider myself a racer. I consider myself a performer. And what the word hot dog was the first word or termination. I consider it kind of crazy skiing. We kind of try to consider ourselves professional freestyle skiers. Like in a ballet run, say 1,000 feet, you change edges about 500 times. So as easy as it makes, you know, it might look, you choreograph your run and you practice it over and over and over. It's really hard to do it gracefully. And the way to do it smoothly is to have a boot that's flexible that you can press forward all the way to the front of the ski and come back all the way to the back of the ski. And the more that you learn about upper body balance, like practicing on a trampoline, it really helps you to do this fluently.
When you get right down to it, how dangerous really is freestyle skiing?
I'll tell you, in the last 3 years, nobody's been hurt at all. I mean, not at all. 4 years ago, a couple of guys were hurt, but it was from trying to make a name for themselves in one day. In other words, they thought if they did a double backflip, they'd be Wayne Wong. And that has completely been dropped now. In other words, like, you do have to qualify. We do have safety qualifications. And the more that you understand about what you're doing, the better off you are.
Tripping and shushing down the artificial slopes. This is Peter Heller, Channel 7 Action News.
I don't really believe Wild Bill O'Leary. I think this is a personal observation. Skiing is very dangerous and hazardous to your health. You can prove it by the insurance policies and what it costs to insure, and skier, that is. We'll be back later in the news with more comments. We'll be talking about Sweetest Day, which was yesterday for both the Lions and the Detroit Red Wings. John, as a skier, would you like to respond?
No, Al. Why should I respond to an obviously biased statement of that kind? It's a great sport, Al. Gets you out in that fresh air, never too far from a bar. A follow-up report on a girl who was bitten by a bat. We'll have that in just a moment. That's the only way I get to meet you, Jack.
I shall beat you, and we won't forget it. You expect more from Standard, and we'll see that you get it.
Jobs to help you keep America clean with our lead free leader Amoco gasoline. We've everything you need for driving these days, and our motor club's there to help you on your way. Our job is service that's ready and right. We're there with repairs to keep you running right.
Our job is you, and we won't forget it. You expect more from Standard, that you get it at Standard. Our job is you at Standard. Our job is you at Standard.
Is this really necessary?
I'm not sharing my secret with anyone, Gloria.
Once you've discovered our unknown Michigan wines, you'll want to keep Warner Vineyards all to yourself. Warner Vineyards just happens to make one of the world's great sherries, Warner Solera Cream Sherry.
What do you say, Gloria?
Oh, Roger, it's...
Warner Solera Cream Sherry. Wait until your friends hear about the unknown one.